very welcome to the Faculty of Geosciences of Utrecht University. You will be visiting the buildings and the laboratories of the Department of Earth Sciences and of the Department of Physical Geography.
Experimental facilities and analytical laboratories are key to frontier research. We are happy to present our laboratories in an overview.
We will start this tour in the university's botanical gardens, where the paleomagnetic laboratory Fort Hofdijk lies. There are no large metal structures, which makes it possible to do very precise measurements to the Earth's magnetic field. This is our automated cryogenic magnetometer, which autonomically makes rock magnetic measurements. It operates 24 hours a day and 7 days a week. Our quantum diamond microscope is the first of its kind in Europe and will be housed in this magnetically shielded room, which is currently being built. With this next generation laser, we will be able to carry out paleomagnetic measurements with very high precision. We continue the tour in the new Earth Simulation Lab, or ESL.
This is the metronome, a steel basin to create estuaries at a scale of about 1 in 2000. So what we're doing here is tilting the basin periodically to drive the tidal currents. Past experiments used water level fluctuations in a scaled sea, but the problem with that is that the currents are too small to move the sand. And the other scale problem is that we have to have coarse sand to avoid ripple formation. They have to be bars that scale well with what happens in nature. So we're tilting the entire basin, only modestly. The ends go up and down 10 centimeters over a period of 40 seconds. And with that, we have a time scale as well as a spatial scale of about 1 in 2000. We are rebuilding it in this new laboratory setting, which is fantastic because then we'll have better lighting, which will allow us to do automated image analysis on the time-lapse imagery that we collect for each experiment.
In the same room, other researchers work with the debris flow flume.
So behind me you see the landslide flume. So we try to unravel with this flume why some debris flows become very dangerous and why other debris flows stay fairly safe because they stay quite small. So what do we do? We have a mixing tank on my right in which we mix materials, mostly gravel, sand, clay and some water. Under the proper angle, this material flows out, and then on the lower 2 meters of the flume, there is an erodible bed, and there we measure how much erosion this particular debris flow under the particular circumstances causes.
To carry out research on natural systems such as debris flows, the departments have a wide array of several drones. Both in the field and in the lab, we use our spectrometer to be able to measure the spectral signature and identify rocks, minerals and vegetation.
What you see behind me is one of our newest high-end instruments that we have purchased just a couple months ago through the EPOS-NL project. With this X-ray tomography system, we want to understand in 3 dimensions of how rocks are failing to cause earthquakes or how fluids are traveling through them. We're not just gonna scan the rocks static, but we're actually gonna, in the future, conduct experiments within this system to really understand the dynamics of fluid movement of rock failure.
Next in the ESL, we will visit the high pressure and temperature lab.
Now, this is one of our triaxial deformation machines. This is the most recent one that we have developed. This was specifically developed to study the in-situ behavior of reservoir rocks in response to the extraction of fluids from the subsurface, like oil or gas in this case. We use this machine to do experiments trying to understand the seismicity in the Groningen gas field. This machine, as you can see here, it can be heated up to a few hundred degrees. It can be pressurized up to 1,000 bars or 1,000 times atmospheric pressure. And what we can do is we can actively deform rock samples within here. Now with this specific machine, what is really new here, what is state of the art, is that we can impose the confining pressure and perform the actual shortening test as we do with our other machines, but we can also impose different boundary conditions. We can, for example, prevent the sample from spreading sideways. So we can impose boundary conditions that are much more in line with what is actually happening in nature. And then the second really nice thing that we can do with this machine is we can measure all of these little displacements in the machine itself. Normally it's all measured on the outside, which requires a lot of corrections for machine distortions. Here we can measure it on the rock sample itself with all of these sophisticated sensors that we've built specifically for this machine.
Next, we will visit the Tectonic Lab, where researchers use scaled analog models to better understand large-scale tectonic deformation processes.
With the following experiment, which is part of a master project, we are interested to see how the movement of Anatolia, which is going in relatively northwest direction, causes the development of a very complicated fault pattern, which we see now in Turkey. What we are looking now on this table is basically the experimental results I just explained. And what you see is a plate mimicking Anatolia, which is this brownish looking shaped plate, which has been pushed against the model itself, which you see here. And that created substantial deformation. And the expression of that deformation is the formation of these structures you see when looking on top of the experiments, like the one I'm pointing to, which are basically very large-scale fault structures cutting through the Earth's surface and the upper crust. EPOS-NL, the Dutch infrastructure program, allows us to further invest into monitoring systems, such as CT scanning and laser vibrometry, which we will develop in the very near future. Both methods allow us to gain insight in what happens within an experiment during the experiment is running, which is not possible as it is now, which means a major advancement in the analysis of analog experiments.
These are some of our most recently acquired electron microscopes: the Thermo Fisher Scientific Spectra 300, the Zeiss Evo 15, and the Thermo Fisher Scientific Helios G3 Nanolab. We use them to investigate the structure and chemistry of Earth materials. We can go across the full range of scales, from atomic resolution to tens of centimeters in 2D and 3D. This is our repository, where we store most of our samples. Using a QR code system, we were able to keep track of what we have and where it is stored. In our old-fashioned but still modern repository, we keep samples such as fossils and rocks. In the cool storage, we keep samples such as loose soil and soil cores. In the Geolab, we use several isotope spectrometers, such as the nanosims, to obtain in-situ analysis of elemental and isotopic composition of a sample, with a resolution of down to 50 nanometers. Our state-of-the-art electron microprobe is mainly used for the quantitative analyses of major and minor elements, from boron to uranium, down to concentrations of 100 ppm. Our two gas isotope ratio mass spectrometers are specifically set up for the analysis of very small carbonate samples of sub 100 microgram. This allows us to accurately reconstruct past temperatures from a wide range of carbonate samples.
So this is our preparation lab. Here we extract biomarkers from environmental samples, and these could be marine sediments or lake sediments or particles in the water column or soils or plants. And we use those biomarkers to study carbon cycle dynamics or make paleoclimate reconstructions or look at the food web structure. And after we have extracted the biomarkers and separated them in different fractions, we take them to our instrument lab, where we analyze them on the GCs that we have or the LCMS that we have. If we are interested in their isotopic composition, we take them to the GC-IRMS.
In our large experimental lab, we have several acrylic and glass glove boxes to work with.
This is PALAS, the Planetary Analog Laboratory for Light, Atmosphere and Surface Simulations. What we can do here is we can simulate planetary surfaces, and we can simulate three different things. First, there is a table which we can cool and heat to simulate surface temperatures. Then we can adjust the atmosphere and the composition of the atmosphere. And we can work up to 1 bar, so a little bit lower actually than ambient pressure. With that we can simulate Mars pressure, early Earth pressure, current day Mars pressure, early Mars pressure, asteroid surfaces. And the third thing we can simulate is using this lamp, and this lamp is a solar simulator. And what this lamp does, it radiates light with the spectrum of the sun, including part of the ultraviolet radiation. And with this we can simulate the sunlight on a planetary surface.
Our environmental hydrogeology group hosts the Multiscale Porous Materials Lab, which also has a clean room. Usually, such a lab is housed by science or biology departments, but for our purposes, we have one in the geosciences department. Through this lab, we have also established strong collaborations between geo and science faculties in UU. One of our activities here is to fabricate precise microscopic chips representing rock and soil pores, on which we perform advanced experiments with our in-house optic setups. In order to store all the data from our research, we have a high-performance computer. This computer is cooled using a sustainable cooling system, the residual heat of which is used to heat the building in colder months. We hope that with this film, we were able to give you an overview of our great lab facilities.